Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Selamat berpuasa to those who are observing the fast in Ramadan. My name is Farid. I am from Telekom Malaysia Berhad. I do strategy in Telekom. And I'm here today. I've been asked by Patrick and Azran to talk and to present Telekom's journey in transforming ourselves through our history. I asked Azran why should I present a telco topic in front of digital people? Because digital relies on telco. Wouldn't people know what telco is all about in any case? So Azran basically said, look, the digital journey is an evolving one, and it evolves together with how the underlying infrastructure evolves, and that is us, and that's why Azran asked me to come up here. Telekom Malaysia is a little different from Axiata Digital. Axiata Digital is, as Kevin or as Khairil put it, is an investor. We are an operator. We are an operator. We operate national infrastructure for connectivity services. That's basically what we are. We are a service provider, we're an operator. So in that sense, we are not technology movers, we are technology enablers. That's what we are. So the journey has been a long one, actually. From well before I was born in 1946, we were a department of the government. Of course, at the time, the government was the British government. We were founded, therefore, by the British in that sense, way back in 1946. In fact, if you drive around, for some of you that's observant enough to look at your feet as you walk on the streets, you will still see some manholes with the Malaysian Telecommunications Department label. It does not say Telekom Malaysia. That's how long we have been around, and you will see JT, you will see J, telephone logo, T. Telephone logo, by the way, guys, is not this telephone logo. Telephone logo as in this telephone logo. Some of you may not have been born yet to know what I mean when you do this. It's actually a phone that you actually have to dial. In the old days, people dial like this. So that is Telekom Malaysia. And then by the foresight of our leaders at the time, they thought that Malaysia, the country, has to progress in its economic landscape. And they thought that the best pathway is to create companies out of government departments. The rationale being, companies would have a different mindset. The companies would be more adapt to commercial pressures and move on and innovate and become more effective, more efficient, and so on and so forth. So back in 1987, we were then privatized. We became Syarikat Telekom Malaysia Berhad, and 3 years later, we were then listed in the stock market as Telekom Malaysia Berhad. Now, why do I spend... Where's the clock, by the way? Why do I spend time to explain these two steps? Because I want to explain to you the tough journey that we had. Some of you may have worked with or interacted with government departments, and some of you would have interacted with private sector, pure private sector companies. We had to be both, and we had to transform ourselves in handling both situations. And even until today, we have some legacy, our DNA, and so on and so forth, needs to recognize the fact that we are part of the country, part of the nation, part of the government machinery, to and yet be involved, be embedded in the commercial machinery. So let me explain what that means. In 2008, as an example, we did two big things in 2008. First was, we demerged Axiata. Telekom Malaysia Berhad, in the past, was an integrated telecoms operator. We had TMI, what was is now called Axiata. We had Celcom, which is our mobile services at the time, and we had fixed line services. we decided to demerge these two entities to provide greater transparency in performance between the fixed line and between and the mobile services in the form of Axiata together with the regional mobile services. We thought transparency was key to showing the performance of the fixed line business in this particular instance. I now represent the fixed line business. Without performance transparency, there will be no pressure to improve. Yes, it starts off with the need to improve our bottom line and our revenues and our financial results. But that would only happen, if there is improvements in service quality, improvements in the availability of infrastructure, and so on and so forth. So in 2008, the first thing that happened is a demerger. The second thing that happened is the rollout of high-speed broadband services, or FTTH services. The infrastructure build-out began in 2008. What many people now would recognize as UniFi. UniFi is the brand name, or the corporate brand name, public brand name of the high-speed broadband service. Now, why is that important? Why do I link that to the story of us being embedded in the with the DNA of the government and embedded with the thinking of nation first in conjunction with commercial principles? The reason is, if you really, really think about it, no high-speed broadband service, FTTH service, on its own, commercially, is a non-viable proposition. It's a non-viable commercial proposition in any country. The cost to roll out for one home will take you at least 15 years to recoup in terms of profits, because that is actually what it takes. For many of you, you just see the existence of blinking lights in your home and the existence of service, but what you do not see is the immense amount of work to lay the fiber cables right up leading to your home. Outside your home, you will see ducts being dug. Let me tell you the amount of fiber we've laid. The amount of fiber we laid across the country is enough to go from the earth to the moon 3 times. That's how much fiber we laid across the country. And that is not cheap. And therefore, the partnership with government is key in getting services out to everybody. That's point number one. Point number two is, unfortunately, or fortunately, that also means that we have to think of the whole country. We cannot think of just you, people in Kuala Lumpur. We have to think of both urban people, suburban people, and rural people. And there will be trade-offs, and there will be not just trade-offs, but there will essentially be cross-subsidization between these segments. And that is the reason why, if you see our numbers, our broadband penetration is among the highest in the region because we tried to balance all three. The problem with balancing is we will never be the best in all three. We openly admit upfront we will never be the best in all three. The reason is we try to balance the needs of all. That's been the framework that this country has undertaken over time. Over many years, we tried to cater for everybody. If we just focused on Kuala Lumpur, Kuala Lumpur services would be as good as Singapore or even better. But we are not Singapore. I think that's an important point to note. But back to the transformation journey. The transformation journey was then undertaken in 2008. It was an extremely, extremely tough journey. Why do I say that? Why can't we just roll out? Isn't it just an engineering problem? It is an engineering problem. It is an organizational problem. It is a mindset problem, and so on and so forth. One thing you must know, or at least if you were part of the industry at the time, you will probably know. In 2006 to 2008, the rate of decline of the financial performance of Telekom Malaysia was among the worst in the world. Among the worst in the world. We were basically falling off the cliff in terms of our financial performance vis-a-vis our revenues. Why was that? The reason is, in Malaysia, there's something called fixed line substitution. The mobile space was picking up like crazy. And mobile space was picking up voice services. So our voice service, our voice solutions, you know, the phones you have at home, people are no longer using it. And we were not ready for the next wave at the time. We were not ready for broadband. So what happened in 2008 was we need to do all these shifts simultaneously. So think of trying to fly a 747 whilst changing its wheels and changing its wings and converting the 747 to a fighter plane whilst flying. That's effectively what we did in 2008. As a result, what do you have today? Today, we have 1.8 million broadband customers across the country, broadband households. In terms of customers, it's actually four times that because one household is actually four, on average, four people. We have delivered 2.3 million FTTH ports. And according to various studies by various international agencies, BT, McKinsey, and so on and so forth, the rate of rollout that we did from 2008 onwards was the fastest in the world, actually number three fastest in the world in terms of rollout of FTTH services. And we continue to roll out, and we continue to upgrade our services in terms of broadband. Recently, as you may know, we have launched our Unified Advance, where we've moved away from the VIP offering, 5, 10, 20. We now have a higher entry speed at 30 Mbps and so on and so forth. So that was a bit of the journey. But what was the framework, the overall strategic framework that we have undertaken and we will continue to undertake? Yes, underlying all of it was a business imperative of growth, the business imperative of improving productivity and becoming an institution. I think most companies, when they have the strategy roadmap, will have variations of the same. Because at the end of the day, what is a company about? At the end of the day, is a company is about making profits for the longest time possible. So that's fine. All of us would have this. But what's interesting is these two boxes here, which I would like to spend maybe 2 minutes on. Here is what we call the information exchange. Information exchange, if you will, is almost essentially infrastructure services, the traditional telco. But even then, we've called it information exchange. That is to signal to our people that the new telco is different. The new telco enables other telcos. It's an exchange. That's why we have services, we provide services to our competitors, we provide services to Maxis, we provide services to Time.com and all the rest of it. Because the only way a telco network becomes profitable or becomes valuable to the country and to ourselves is when it's larger. In order to be larger, there needs to be an exchange of information between telcos. And that is a big mindset shift for many, many people. I think Kyril hinted at that earlier as well. What's interesting for this room is the realization that we need something else. We need what we, in our lingo, we call innovation exchange. Innovation exchange is where we exchange capabilities with our partners. So it is designed separately in a separate box because the way to run a telco service and the way to run innovation is different. So innovation is about enablement. From our perspective at least, and innovation is about enablement, innovation is about partnership, innovation is about jointly taking risks. That's basically what it is. So what does this mean? This means here, we will continue to invest in our network, we will run our network, and we'll keep our network reasonably open for our competitors and for our partners to participate in. What does this mean? This means we are open for business. We will enable our partners to come together with us, and we have no intention to desegregate our partners. In simple words, we will never be an Uber. We do not have an intention to go digital and invest in or replicate something like Uber, as an example. Our intention is merely to partner Uber. If Uber has a great idea to partner with us, utilizing our infrastructure services and information, our mobile services, for example, we are more than happy to discuss and have a discussion. So that's where we are. In simple terms, in the short term, we will deliver convergence services. As you know, we are launching our WeeBee service. Many of you will know that. So we will start launching a mobility service, but not for the sake just of pure mobility. We will see mobility within the context of all our suite of telco services, and that's how we define convergence. And we will go digital. Everyone talks about going digital. Zafro talked about going digital earlier. Our digital journey, at least for the consumer segment, is not too dissimilar. It's all about customer experience and simplifying the interaction between the customer and ourselves. We will try to move as many of that interaction as possible onto digital channels and simplifying it across these seven digital journeys. I won't spend much more time other than to close off with the key takeaway is we are open for business. We are open for business in the form of partnerships across all grounds because the new telco can no longer afford to be a singular telco. Thank you very much.